Hi, I'm Tom Polansky, Associate Vice President of Facilities here at Occidental College. Well, many folks are familiar with some of the landmarks on campus that we've loved for years, such as Thorne Hall, Swan Hall, and Remsen Bird Hillside Theater. Many of us have not seen some of the hidden gems here on campus, known mostly by their reputations, such as the utility tunnel system. Today, we're going to go behind the velvet rope. We're going to take a peek at some of these hidden jewels on campus. I think you'll enjoy it. We're here in Grisham Dining Hall, part of Myron Hunt's 1928 plan for Freeman Union. In front of me are two dining chairs, an original and one that's been refurbished, much like we've refurbished a number of the classrooms around campus. Over here, we have an original Batchelder tile drinking fountain with two peacocks facing each other in the design. And then, if we pan up, you can see the original open span wood beams. This allows the space to be very large, spans very big for big events on campus here. You may also notice this little Juliet balcony. We're about to find out what used to be up there. Generations of Occidental students have walked behind Johnson Student Center and have noticed this beautiful wrought iron staircase. The staircase actually leads up to the second floor former apartment of Clancy, who was the director of campus dining for decades here. Now, I don't know all there is to know about Clancy and her apartment, but we're about to hear from someone that does.
Hi, I'm Amy Munoz, Associate Vice President for Hospitality Services, and this is my predecessor and mentor, Clancy Morrison.
Dr. Gilman, I remember 23 years ago, you were the choice of my staff long before the announcement was made that you were to be our president. I don't remember any dislikes that you had, except perhaps one. Miss Morrison, that dish last night, vermicelli, I think it was, we don't want to have that anymore, do we?
Clancy hired me in September 1984 to be her assistant director of food services. Some things that some people may not know about Clancy. Well, she was a civilian dietitian in the Army in World War II. That was her job prior to coming here to Occidental. She was from a small town in Alabama. She was the youngest of a number of children. Of course, she wasn't a chef. She had a series of chefs that she really loved and appreciated. She just, she revered her chef. So she was totally committed to her job. And she was on the floor 80 hours a week. And that was when she lived a few blocks off campus. I can only imagine when she actually lived in the building that she was just constantly at work. But she told me she had lived in the apartment on the third floor of JSC, then Freeman College Union. This would likely have been for over 30 years, from 1944 to her first retirement date around 1976. The apartment was spacious and had a splendid view facing west across the football field. A long balcony went almost the full length. The apartment had a tiny kitchen with a real icebox, the kind that you put a block of ice in once every day or two. The tower chimes were in a small crawl space off the last room. Now, there are many stories of Clancy looking down on the dining room from her apartment, but actually that Juliet balcony is part of a small office, separate from the apartment. And when the building was remodeled in 1997 to 98, there was talk of creating a cafe on the third floor, but the ADA requirements would have made that extremely expensive. The dining room was at last going to be air conditioned after all, and we needed space for the HVAC units. The historic tile roof is sloped, so the apartment was the practical choice. And you know, she had never married, never had children. Her family was far away, so this was her family. And one of the kindest things she ever said to me was, "I was the right person for that time. You're the right person for this time." The other thing she would say from her bed was, "Could somebody please get me some whiskey?"
We've all seen the bell tower behind me. It's part of the 1928 original Myron Hunt design for Johnson Student Center. Bell tower actually disguises a steam tower. Next, we'll go take a look and see how those bells actually work inside of Johnson Student Center. We're now inside the main boiler room for the campus, within a hidden compartment that houses this red phone. I have no idea why this red phone is here. Under this phone is this computer that controls the Carillon Bell system. You can see here where the different programs are available. President Beach, in fact, commissioned a piece to play every year on April Fool's Day. That song, some say, sounds like an alien invasion. The sounds play through what looks like a bell tower, but as we know, is in fact a steam tower. Let me show you what it sounds like. I'm standing in what was formerly Clancy's bathroom. So this window here sort of sums up what happened to her apartment, in that we brought in mechanical equipment into the apartment space as part of the remodel for Johnson Student Center in 1989. Next, I'll climb this ladder to get into the bell tower. Or, because there are no actual bells in the bell tower, in facilities, we refer to it as the steam tower. Next, we're heading over to Thorne Hall. I stand before Thorne Hall with its four beautiful Doric columns. Thorne Hall beautifully caps the end of a major campus axis. It was designed by Myron Hunt in 1938. You're probably all familiar with the incredible performances you've seen within Thorne Hall over the years, but you're probably not as familiar with the spaces we're about to show you. Let's go take a look.
Roll it!
The mystery we'll be exploring today within Thorne is the old pipe organ space. Now, interestingly, the organist used to play the organ up on the side of the stage, but the pipes were all in the back. Let's go take a look at those old spaces. I think you'll find them very interesting.
Okay, so let's go up to the projection booth. Behind this door, half of the 4,000 organ pipes for the original Thorne Hall organ were located. Let's take a look. So within this cavernous space, the organ pipes stood 30, 35 feet tall, the huge bass pipes, and I saw them as they were getting removed. Each pipe was about that big in diameter. Some were wood, some were metal. There's just a little bit of light in here, didn't need much. Another room we'll show you in just a second had the large blower motor. So the organist would be playing up at the stage. You might wonder, how does the sound from all these pipes get out to the audience? Let me show you this. These panels pull back to allow the sound from 4,000 large pipes to fill Thorne Hall with beautiful organ music. Just imagine a Bach concerto being pumped out through all these pipes into Thorne Hall. Amazing.
I'm standing inside the room that used to house the blower equipment for the Thorne Hall organ. You can imagine just how much air was required to make that organ sing. So inside this room, there was a very loud blower motor that ducted air, very high velocity air, through these concrete holes. You can see how thick this room had to be in order to contain all the noise so that the audience wouldn't hear the blower motor. This is all beautifully hand cast, similar to the rest of Thorne Hall's walls. Now we're in the opposite side of the cavernous space that housed the rest of the organ. This organ was donated by Trustee Elizabeth Clapp McBride, class of 1919, and her husband Euclid McBride. It was an Aeolian Skinner organ, which was the top-of-the-line organ for concert halls like Thorne Hall at the time. It had four manual keyboards, a pedal keyboard,
and 68 stops. It was installed in 1938 with the rest of the building, and it was played by some of the most famous organists of the 20th century. In 1989, the auditorium underwent a major interior renovation, and the decision was made to remove the organ console to make way for a new stage wheelchair lift. Occidental sold the organ in 2007, and after a decade-long pause, the organ left campus in 2018 to undergo a complete restoration in Connecticut before making its way to its new home. So now that we've seen one of Thorne's mysteries, it's now time for the moment you've all been waiting for. It's time to go explore those tunnels. Let's go.
Where'd you guys hear about them?
I'm not sure where you heard about them.
Really?
Maybe from like an upperclassman.
What were you guys expecting if you guys ever got down there?
A secret passage in between Fowler and Johnson, like teachers go through or administrators.
I know it's an Oxy legend. I know that like there's like 1,000 signatures down there.
I'm told there's like a big open area that you can get to. I don't know if that's true.
Who'd you hear that from?
I don't know, I guess it's just kind of urban legend.
But yeah. Pick the lock to the electrical board,
and some cell
extra
phones,
batteries.
Extra batteries.
Cell phones that don't work.
The tunnels have been a part of Occidental lore since the college's founding. In 1974, an article in the Occidental mentions that if students wanted to tour the tunnels, they would simply need to contact the director of facilities, which is unimaginable today with current safety standards.
We're at the entrance to the infamous Occidental College utility tunnel system right behind this door. These tunnels house high pressure steam, electric, and chilled water. So it is a very bad idea to try to enter these systems. Even our own facility staff have to go through a rigorous safety protocol to enter these tunnels. So please do not try to get into these tunnels. As few have seen before, you will see in just a minute how interesting these tunnels are in a safe way on video. Follow me. We're now inside the utility tunnels that connect many of the earliest buildings on campus designed and built by Myron Hunt from 1911 through 1940. These tunnels allow all the utility lines to connect the various buildings in a way to keep the campus above ground bucolic and free from unsightly power lines and things like that. In addition to chilled water and steam, we have ITS's fiber optic lines that bring us our internet.
More rumors about the utility tunnels, that when they were digging out the tunnels, there was an underground stream discovered, and there was much debate on campus about using the water for the college, but the president at the time decided against it. Two mules were actually buried under Johnson Hall when the foundation concrete was poured because of swamp-like land that was discovered during construction. Are any of these rumors true? Nobody really knows.
So we're down here in the tunnels. And you'll notice most of the graffiti is from the 1970s, which was before we upgraded and installed quite a bit more of these pipes, which made access much more dangerous down here. There's graffiti here that mentions Orr Chilcott Expedition. Orr was the original name for Weingart Hall. It was a women's dormitory. And then Long Live Gilman, former President Gilman, and the college seal, a lamp. So there are two urban legends that apply to the tunnel system. One, that faculty use the tunnels to go from building to building. It's not true. Second one, that there's a huge party room of some kind underneath Thorne Hall. There is no large party room under Thorne Hall. It's a crawl space about 3 feet high, dirt on the bottom, hot pipes, high power electric lines above.
So there is no party room in Thorne Hall, and faculty don't use tunnels like this.
There are tunnels underneath Occidental College, and yes, I found my way down in them. There are thousands of signatures, high voltage power lines, and lots of other dangerous things. Yet we found no large party room.
We're back here in Occidental College's beautiful quad, surrounded by Myron Hunt's first buildings on campus, with the beautiful oak trees placed by Beatrix Ferran, the original landscape architect for the college. It really feels like home here. I hope you all have enjoyed this tour today of Occidental College's hidden spaces, and look forward to seeing you again back on campus soon. Thank you.